pointing out that in different languages, you know, the way different cultures divide up the color spectrum is very different. Blue and green, often not distinguished in some cultures. So that, yeah, that's also it. Yes, no, C can be many. Okay, I think I'll get cracking. Today I had set out my lecture. I was going to do the same as yesterday and do the literary text and then the visual stuff. But I've just got too much stuff in the lecture. I'm going to just have to skim through some of it. And I think let's do justice to the visual stuff rather. I'll go to that first and then go back to the text. And I thought anyway, even if I can't deal with most of these texts, you at least have them to take away with you, whereas the images you won't have. So let me zoom down to here. Yeah. Okay, so we'll start with the visual stuff. The Odyssey and the visual arts of the 20th and 21st centuries. And I'll just look again at just certain instances. Collage and brief glance at TV and a brief glance at film. And I'll just look at one, you know, two examples of each. For me, one of the most appealing artistic treatments of the Odyssey in the 20th century is that by the American artist whose name you can see up there, Romare Bearden. And you've got his dates up there. Bearden was active mainly in New York, in Harlem, came just after the Harlem Renaissance of the 20s. And he was a founding member of the Black Academy of Arts and Letters. In 1977, he produced a wonderful series of collages, paper cutout collages with added paint of the Odyssey. All the characters in his, he also did some watercolors based on that. I don't think they're as successful, but the collages I think are fantastic. All the characters are black, like him, and the landscapes they move through suggest West and North Africa. Here are a couple of, well, this is Bearden himself, a photograph and then a self-portrait by the artist. And here are the 1977 series of collages. So, Poseidon, I've got a pointer today. You can see conceived of as a kind of African Nigerian god, maybe a mask-like face with his wonderful blue hair, which is a bit like what you see in some ancient frescoes from Thera, actually, where characters have blue hair, fish indicating the marine environment. And Bearden's very fond of this kind of zigzag African motif. He uses it a lot in the collages, as we'll see. And he's armed with his Bearden's own version of a trident, a kind of harpoon, and a little kind of arm shield on his arm, and expressing the kind of anger which Poseidon expresses against Odysseus in the Odyssey. Here's his, again, wonderful version of Circe, who's, of course, in the Western tradition in Homer, kind of witch goddess. Here he turns her into a kind of obeah medicine, mooty woman. The skull, you can see in both of these, again, the zigzag and tooth motifs. And here's a lion, presumably one of the animals into which she's transformed. Transformed one of the people who came to her before Odysseus, because this doesn't happen with Odysseus, and various animals on her person, a snake and a bird. Again, a very individual rendering of Odyssey motifs. And here, home to Ithaca, presumably Odysseus with shield on his ship. And here are these palm trees indicating, you know, kind of African tropical kind of countryside, and these buildings, you know, kind of indeterminate culture, perhaps sort of Moroccan, but not tied to any very specific geographical locality. There's a marvelous quote from Bearden, which I'd like to read to you. Bearden said, an artist is an art lover who finds that in all the art that he, or she, but he says only he, all the art that he sees, something is missing, and becomes the artist's job to put there what he experiences missing, unquote. So that's why we get these African settings for Bearden's version of the Odyssey. And in, you know, my own small way, that's what I was trying to do with my Homer translations, to put in something there that I felt was missing in all the translations that I'd used to teach and read over the decades, you know, my own South African experience and language and so on. So I can understand what he was getting at, in, and I think I was influenced by it as, by him as well. Bearden's Odyssey collages, they're by no means inert illustrations of the epic. The images often go their own way and do kind of different things. They take up themes common to Bearden's lifelong artistic production. So themes that Bearden saw as intrinsic to black life in America were things like heroic endurance, the legacy of slavery, resilience, overcoming mortal dangers, homelessness and exile. You can see how all many of these things would resonate with the Odyssey. The search for a home, and also the finding of a kind of idealized home in the imagination. Very important to Bearden also, he was very interested in jazz, and the kind of, so he was interested in a kind of jazz-like attitude of improvisation and adaptability, being able to, and he saw that in Odysseus, this kind of endlessly quick, versatile, adaptable character. He did many paintings and collages of jazz musicians and jazz clubs as well. Okay, so most of his Odyssey collages are open to more than one single obvious relation to the text of the Odyssey, open to multiple interpretations. Let's look at a couple. It's one of my favorites. The sea nymph from Odyssey Book 5. If you remember the action of Odyssey Book 5, Odysseus leaves Calypso's island, he builds his own boat. The boat is shipwrecked by that angry Poseidon we saw a moment ago. And as Odysseus is completely naked in the water, swimming for the island he's seen in the far distance, almost drowning, a sea goddess, Leucothea, takes pity on him and lends him her veil. Says, this veil can save you from drowning, and he ties it around his waist. Okay, this is Bearden's interpretation of that episode. You can see that there's a storm going on, the ship's mast is broken, you see that crooked angle, sail is crumpled, the waves are heaving. So this is Odysseus's raft, which hasn't broken to pieces, so he's interpreted it differently. And here's the figure of the hero way under the surface of the sea, so very different from the Odyssey. So we have the goddess figure diving deep down into the water to this figure. And the male figure there looks very much like someone at the edge of death, already dead. And the veil of the Odyssey looks much more like a kind of shroud or winding sheet that's gone right around the body. So I think Bearden is taking this episode of the Odyssey, and to me it suggests perhaps the miraculous rescue of some slave thrown overboard on the middle crossing, and this goddess figure coming to unwrap him and rescue him, or rescuing a figure that's almost on the edge of death and will be brought back to the surface. But it's a very interesting interplay with the text of the Odyssey. Okay, then there's his version of the siren song. We've seen quite a few artistic representations of sirens, so you can, Bearden was very aware of the whole tradition of Western art and often plays with it. So I'm sure some of those paintings we looked at would have been known to him. So the sirens here, as in the Odyssey, are in the distance on the shore with the ship some way away. Bearden adds a nice touch here, like this figure sort of in the classical robes and playing a stringed instrument, but it looks like some kind of African stringed instrument. It's not a lyre, certainly not the sort of classical stringed lyre. And here these siren figures reaching out, calling towards the ship. But the artist also clearly radically reinterprets Homer. The figure of Odysseus is not just tied to the mast, but it's kind of strung up halfway up the mast there. And he's also added this cross piece to make the mast look like a cross. So I think maybe what Bearden is hinting at here is something that was actually argued by certain Christian church fathers, that Odysseus bound to his mast was an allegory of Christ on the cross. So he might be picking up that kind of idea of Odysseus representing kind of suffering humanity. I think also something that's almost certainly at play here is memories of lynchings in the Deep South in the US, and also the association of the cross with the Ku Klux Klan. So, you know, there are these multiple meanings, I think, at play in his collages, which are ostensibly about the Odyssey, but also about his own artistic and moral, cultural concerns. Yes. This one. Sorry? Well, the only, what's said is that he was going across the Aegean, and a huge northern gale comes out and sends him for days across the sea, and he ends up on some coast. So people have traditionally said that's the coast of North Africa. Yeah. So there is that link in the tradition. Okay, here's where Bearden uses a classical Renaissance painting by Pintoricchio, a fresco from 1509, Penelope and Her Suitors. Let's just have a quick look at Pintoricchio first. This combines many moments of the Odyssey narrative into one image, a little bit like that Allori picture of Circe we saw yesterday, where you had Circe and in the background you had Hermes and Odysseus. So there are two moments shown there. Here, what we've got are young suitors catching Penelope at her weaving. So, oops, let's go back. There's Penelope, here's the loom, here's a maidservant sitting next to her, perhaps the one who has betrayed her trick to the suitors, and here are the suitors lined up, sort of rich, idle young men, this one with a hawk on his arm, you can see the hawk there, and this one with a sort of Raphaelesque stare up into the heavens. And here we've got Odysseus, you can see only grey-bearded, older-looking character, disguised as a beggar, arriving in the doorway with his, you can see a stick for his knapsack over his back there. But there are also other moments of the Odyssey narrative in the background. You can't see very clearly, but see these little animals here. There's Circe with a lion and pigs, and Odysseus encountering her. And we've also got the sirens. There are sailors on this boat jumping into the water, and here are the sirens. You can maybe just see holding two fishtails up in either hand, and you've also got Odysseus there tied to a spar on his ship, very Renaissance sort of ship, in the background. And then also adding a bit of drama to the scene, this cat playing with a ball of yarn, perhaps suggesting Penelope is playing with the suitors. And in the background, Odysseus's bow and the arrows that are going to be used for the contest and the vengeance. So, Bearden calls his image Return of Odysseus, homage to Pintoricchio and Benin. As you can see, Bearden closely follows Pintoricchio's composition, but he transforms the picture's meaning. As always, his characters are black, and he introduces his usual African motifs in Penelope's weaving over there. And in his composition, he replaces at least one, perhaps two of the suitors by women. You can see this turbaned figure becomes this figure here with a slender neck. Has to be a woman, I think. And perhaps this figure as well, but that could also be a man in the kind of jellaby or long caftan in the background there. And here, instead of Odysseus, we've got a suitor with a drawn dagger in his hand coming through the doorway. And this, as far as I can see, seems to be Odysseus, because he's pointing to a token on his chest which is identical to one worn by Penelope, so it seems to be indicating his identity and that it's her husband returned. Here we have the same maidservant again, this time weeping, perhaps because of her betrayal of Penelope. And again, the cat and the bow and the arrows. The bird has got a more African form. It looks a bit more like an ibis up there than whatever that is, a swallow or not quite sure. Okay, so that's Bearden and his collages. I'd like to move down to the popular end of the visual scale with TV. There was quite a good TV miniseries of the Odyssey put out in 1997. It had some pretty good, well-known actors in it. Greta Scacchi as Penelope, Armand Asante as Odysseus. He was very good Odysseus. Isabella Rossellini as Athena, and a very seductive Vanessa Williams as Calypso. She's great in that role. We used to show it to our students just to try and hold their interest by something visual, because there's such visual culture now. We won't have a look at that, but you can see the extent to which staying with TV, how far Odyssey has penetrated into popular culture. There's even an episode of The Simpsons, season 13, episode 14, where Homer Simpson, that is, gets a notice from the library that he's got an overdue book, and it's called Classic Tales. So he sits down to read it and goes into a reverie, and we get these kind of episodes from the Odyssey. The Cyclops. This is, I think, the barman Moe, isn't it? The Odysseus as Cyclops eats his humans raw, but here it's a kind of Euro arrangement with these torches and some basting brush over there and various Simpson characters there. And then the sirens. Marge's sisters, not terribly enticing, with a kind of half-smoked cigarette between their fingers on the shore. Quite interesting, these palm trees in the background. I don't know if the cartoonist had seen the Bearden collages. Might well have. It looks almost a bit Bearden-like, the background there. And just a Marge with a picture of the young Homer Odysseus. And I think this is also a good example of how much popular culture feeds off itself, because if you look at this young Homer Odysseus, he looks very like Brad Pitt in the movie Troy. Brad Pitt, Homer. And then finally, Homer, Odysseus, and Marge, Penelope, and the true test of the bed. It wasn't just built, this thing about built, it was how high they could bounce on it. Okay, lastly, with the visual matter on a rather higher artistic plane, I'd like to talk about just one movie. There are plenty of other ones, but just one that clearly has Odyssean links. And this is the Coen brothers, Joel and Ethan Coen's "O Brother, Where Art Thou?" from 2000. How many people have seen it? Okay, so not that many, but I'll explain as we go along. The movie written and directed by the Coen brothers, and the whole thing is one extended and amusing riff on Homer's Odyssey. The Coen brothers claim never to have read the epic, and I think one can take that with a pinch of salt because it's quite clear they know it pretty well. It's funny, this is a kind of trope that you get from different people. I mean, James Joyce claimed he'd never read the Odyssey all the way through, despite showing very detailed knowledge of it in his Ulysses. And Matisse, who did illustrations for it, claimed never to have read Joyce's Ulysses at all. So I don't know why people want to claim not to have read it. Anyway, and they announce their debt right up front. There's a title screen that comes up at the beginning of the movie with the opening lines of the Odyssey. "O muse, sing in me and through me, tell me the story of that man skilled in all the ways of contending, a wanderer harried for years on end." Most of the parallels between the film and the epic are amusingly clear. The hero in the movie is called Ulysses Everett McGill, played by George Clooney. And having escaped from a prison gang, he's journeying with companions back to his home and his wife, who's called Penny. Penny, meanwhile, is being courted by a wealthy suitor. There's also a blind railroad man at the start, who's a Tiresias figure, like blind Tiresias in Book 11 of the Odyssey. And this blind railway man reveals that Ulysses Everett McGill will have to travel, a long and difficult road, a road fraught with peril. We also get a pair of politicians in the film called Menelaus and Homer. And we have a cyclops, played wonderfully by John Goodman, in the form of a one-eyed Bible salesman who violently assaults Ulysses and his companions, but is ultimately defeated. There's a kind of play here. He turns out to be the leader of a local chapter of the Ku Klux Klan. And apparently among their titles, they have a leader called an exalted cyclops. So that's in fact, apparently. So the Coens are playing with that notion. Okay, let's look at... There's Ulysses Everett McGill Clooney in the foreground and his hapless companions. This one is called Delmar. I've forgotten the name of... it's Tim Blake Nelson and... what's his name now? Wonderful actors in most of the Coen brothers' movies. Just slipped my mind for the moment. And then there's John Goodman as the Cyclops with a patch over one eye, making the point. And he's filmed kind of from this very low angle, so he looms over the poor Ulysses and his companion. Okay, another clear Odyssean parallel comes in an episode where the travelers in a car rather than a ship encounter three sexy women singing seductively by a river rather than the sea. The scene combines elements, mainly Odyssey's siren episode as well as less obviously the encounter with Circe. Ulysses is plied with a drug, liquor in this case, and when he and one of his companions wake up, their third companion is missing, and they believe that he's been transformed into a toad that they see sitting by the side of the river, a horny toad, as Delmar says. I've actually got a clip, I hope it'll play.
Shut up, Delmar!
I guess old Pete's got the itch.
Go to sleep, you little thing.
It looks like some of those paintings.
Your mama's gone away and your daddy's gone to stay. Didn't leave nobody but the baby.
How to do, ladies? Name of Pete.
Go to sleep, you little baby. Everybody's gone in the cotton and the corn. Didn't leave nobody but the baby.
Ain't you gonna introduce us, Pete?
I don't know their names. I've seen them first.
You sweet little baby. Sugar don't stop, gonna bring a bottle to the bay. Don't you weep, pretty baby. Don't you weep, pretty baby. She's long gone with her red shoes on. Gonna need another loving baby. Go to sleep, little baby.
Ulysses Everett McGill, and, well, you three ladies are about the prettiest.
Me and the devil makes three, don't
yes.
Need no other loving baby.
Water lilies,
Go to sleep, you little baby. Go to sleep, you little baby. You and me and the devil makes three, don't need no.
Amusingly enough, the Coen brothers said this foolish-looking character, Delmar, the actor was the only one likely to have actually read the Odyssey because he studied classics. He did classics major at Brown University. okay, so those fairly straightforward, amusing parallels between movie and epic. And the last bit I'd like to look at is a much more subtle way in which the Coen brothers play with the fact, which was obviously well known to them, that Homer and his Odyssey came from a tradition that was oral and not written. In the movie, Ulysses, Clooney and his mates, and a black, brilliant black guitarist that they meet up with briefly, they approach a blind local music producer and they pass themselves off as a black blues band, giving themselves the name the Soggy Bottom Boys. And there's several noteworthy aspects to this scene. I'm going to play a clip in a moment. The song that they record, A Man of Constant Sorrows, an existing folk song, is entirely appropriate for Homer's suffering Odysseus. We hear a lot about Odysseus as a man of sorrows in the Odyssey. Obviously, the blind music producer alludes to an ancient tradition that Homer was blind. Homer is, in a sense, Odysseus's producer, presenting him to the world. And in the same way as in the epic tradition, Homer makes Odysseus and comrades famous through the medium of orally performed poetry that's listened to and spread around orally and heard by listening audience. So in the movie, the blind music producer also makes Ulysses Everett McGill and his companions famous But now it's through the modern equivalent of ancient oral poetry, namely the oral medium of recording. It cuts a record, and this record is broadcast over the radio. So this is kind of playing with the oral nature of the Homeric text. Here's a contract. Give them $10. $10 a piece. Okay, so that's my visual part. As I said, I'm going to zip back to the beginning. Okay, so if we go back to our texts, you've got the text of Joyce on page 3 of the handout. So Joyce really presents the fullest and most detailed recreation of the figure of Odysseus. You know, his Ulysses of 1922 is an epic length text. I mean, I don't know how many words it contains, but probably more than Homer's Odyssey. And we'll look at just one episode, just to give you some idea of some part of this work in a moment. Just a few words of introduction to Joyce and Ulysses. Originally, Joyce published Ulysses in serial form in little magazines in Paris from 1918 to 1920. So kind of 2 years or 4 years to 2 years before the actual publication of the book as a single volume. And in that serial publication, Joyce gave each chapter a title from the Odyssey. So he was clearly trying to point out the Odyssean parallels, these Odyssean section titles. For example, the first three sections that were published serially were Telemachus, you know, just like the Odyssey starts with Telemachus, then Nestor, then Menelaus. So the same order as in the Odyssey. Some middle sections of Ulysses were entitled Sirens. In his text, the Sirens are a pair of barmaids in a Dublin pub. Nausicaa, whom we'll look at, Oxen of the Sun episode, which is a kind of phantasmagoria of language. And Circe, which is set in a brothel with Circe as a brothel keeper. And then at the end, the last three sections are called Eumaeus, Ithaca, Penelope. So, you know, clearly alluding very directly to the Odyssey. The main characters of Ulysses are the Ulysses counterpart, Leopold, often called Poldy Bloom, middle-aged Jewish man in Dublin. Remember, Joyce's Ulysses covers only one single day, a specific day in history. So this day is spread out to kind of epic length in Ulysses. And that day, which has subsequently been called Bloom's Day, is June the 16th, our youth day, June the 16th, 1904. And in contrast to the Odyssey, which, you know, has these multiple locations, Ulysses is set just in Dublin on that one day. Okay, and its hero is Bloom. And Joyce kind of saw Ulysses, Odysseus, as a kind of outsider, which he is in the ancient tradition. We saw it as an exceptional hero in many ways. He comes from a marginal part of Greece. He's not a great leader. He doesn't command mighty resources like Agamemnon or Achilles and those characters. So, you know, Joyce deliberately chose a Jewish character as someone being marginal and an outsider, a foreigner within very Catholic Dublin. And Bloom, although he, you know, all he does is potter around Dublin, his thoughts wander very widely. You know, he's not a very educated man, but he's fascinated by everything in the world. His mind keeps ranging over the Middle East, Greece. All kinds of strange facts drift through his mind during the course of the day. So he's got this curiosity. He also has a great interest in people. The equivalent of Telemachus. In fact, Bloom and his wife had a son who died as a child, so they're now childless. And the kind of surrogate son in Ulysses is Stephen Dedalus, who also appears in Portrait of the Hero, if you can call him that, of Portrait of the Artist. So in the course, before we get to that, and then we have Bloom's wife, Molly, the Penelope figure. You know, she likes old Bloom. They haven't had sex in a long time, and she's not particularly faithful to him. She's got a suitor called Blazes Boylan that she sleeps with from time to time. And Bloom has this rather sort of pathetic crush on some woman. He keeps a letter for her in his pocket, so he's got keeping up this surreptitious correspondence with someone. Nothing actually comes of it. So, as I say, the novel traces the wanderings of these two male characters, Bloom representing Ulysses, Daedalus representing Telemachus. So they start off in quite separate narrative, if you can call anything in Ulysses narrative, but they're two different arcs within the novel. And then they meet up about three quarters of the way through. So it's the same structure as the Odyssey, where we had Telemachus wandering in search of his father, Odysseus wandering separately, and then they meet up in book 16 of the Odyssey. And the in Ulysses, Bloom invites Stephen Dedalus home with him, so there's a kind of homecoming for that evening, and he gives him a bed for the night at the end of the novel. Ulysses is, of course, one of the founding texts of so-called modernism. It's people think it's notoriously difficult. I actually love it. I've read it twice. I enjoy it. I mean, it is a complex work, but, you know, I think it's worth persisting. And you might get some enjoyment out of it. It's one of the founding texts, of course, of so-called modernism, which is mainly a reaction against the extreme realism of 19th century art, where, you know, painters and writers purport to be giving you a kind of real, almost a copy of some reality. Modernism undermines this notion of an authoritative stable reality, thinks there's really no such thing. There's just kind of fragments of experience that we try to put together as best we can. So it undermines the notion of a stable reality, does it through irony. You can see that very much in the Nausicaa episode that we'll glance at, and through constant shifts of viewpoint, multiplicity of styles, which you get in Ulysses. Each section is done in a very different style. Could be, looks as if it's by an entirely different writer. At the end of the novel, we get this famous kind of reverie of Molly Bloom, Penelope. It's a 60-page sentence, unpunctuated throughout, just runs on as a continuous stream of consciousness at the end, as she kind of ruminates about her life, about her husband, their child, her lover, and so on, all these thoughts going through her head. In Ulysses, I think it's as if Joyce is saying, if Homer had written now, in the early 20th century, this is what his Odysseus and Penelope would have looked like. But I think he's also doing more than that. I think he's inviting us to discover something extraordinary, perhaps heroic even, in the daily life of a very ordinary, lower middle class urban couple. And his version of the Odyssey and its characters has been definitive for the 20th century. One important thing about Ulysses is that it reestablishes the notion of a centripetal Odysseus, you know, after the centrifugal ones of Dante and Tennyson, going off into the unknown in search of knowledge and experience. Joyce's Odysseus, Ulysses, is very much focused on coming home, coming back to a center, rather than fleeing away from it. Okay, if we can have a quick look at the Nausicaa episode. The whole thing is a third-person narrative, and it's done in the style of a cheap, sugary, romantic story, as if written for an adolescent girl's magazine. And Joyce is playing with, ancient scholars always in love with Nausicaa, this wonderful, virginal, pure maiden who sort of loves Odysseus, but lets him go in the end. And Joyce deals with those sorts of notions with a great deal of irony and undercutting them. Joyce said in a letter what he was aiming at in his Nausicaa episode, the tone, a namby-pamby, jammy, marmalade-y, drawsy style with effects of incense, mariolatry, that Virgin Mary worship, masturbation, stewed cockles, painter's palette, chit-chat, circumlocutions, etc. So the heated romantic style of the whole episode contrasts with the fairly sordid action that's actually going on. In book six of the Odyssey, the teenage Nausicaa and her girlfriends come down to the beach and encounter the naked Odysseus. And in Joyce's Ulysses, there's a parallel encounter between Bloom, who's sitting on the beach, and these young teenage girls, Gertie McDowell, who's the Nausicaa figure, and her girlfriends. And meanwhile, there's a fireworks display going on in the background. I mean, skim thread. And so it begins, like Odysseus and Nausicaa, at last they were left alone without the others to pry and pass remarks. And she knew, this is Gertie admiring Bloom as Nausicaa admires Odysseus, she knew he could be trusted to the death, steadfast, a sterling man, a man of inflexible honor to his fingertips. His hands and face were working. Well, in fact, he's got his hand in his pocket, masturbating in this episode. And a tremor went over her. She leant far back, and so on. And she seemed, a few lines further, she seemed to hear the panting of his heart, his hoarse breathing, because she knew about the passion of men like that, hot-blooded, because her friend Bertha Supple had told her, and so on. And her friend said, few lines on, he used to do something not very nice that you could imagine, sometimes in the bed, but this was altogether different from a thing like that. Well, the irony, of course, is not different at all. And then the fireworks display starts in the next paragraph, about four lines in, and you know, it's an obvious metaphor for what's going on in the scene, and it's meant to be obvious. She saw a long Roman candle going up over the trees, up, up, and in the tense hush, they were all breathless and so on. A few lines on. Her face was suffused with a divine, an entrancing blush from straining back, and he could see her other things too, nainsook knickers and so on and so on. And then at the end, and then a rocket sprang and bang, shot blind, and oh, and the Roman candle burst, and it was like a sigh of oh. Everyone cried oh in raptures, and it gushed out of it a stream of rain, gold hair threads, and ah, green dewy stars, and so on. So it's a kind of wicked parody of the sort of Joyce read many, many girls' magazines of the time to get the tone, to try and get the tone right. So I think what he's doing here is kind of picking up and satirically making explicit that thread of suppressed eroticism in Homer's Nausicaa episode. He's saying, okay, you know, you've got a naked middle-aged man and teenage girls here meeting on the beach, and he sort of spins his version out of that. How are we doing for time? Okay. Okay, 1935, a limited edition of Joyce's Ulysses was banned in many countries. It's a very good book about the unbanning of Ulysses in the States and the kind of fights about censorship that went on around it. Anyway, a limited edition of Joyce's Ulysses was published in 1935 with etchings by the famous Henri Matisse. Matisse said he hadn't read Joyce's novel, and certainly his images seem closer to the Odyssey than specifically to Joyce, although I actually think he had read more than he lets on. Anyway, I'll show you a couple of Matisse's etchings for Ulysses. The preliminary drafts for the etchings were bound into the book together with the final versions. It's very interesting to see how he developed the images. This is Odysseus here with Nausicaa and her handmaidens, so naked Odysseus and these heavily clothed girls. This is what becomes, I mean, it's fascinating to see how Matisse ruthlessly prunes away all the kind of realistic elements in the image and makes it into an abstract pattern, a very modernist type of treatment. Sometimes the images are very abstract, less so here. But it's interesting to see how he's changed it. I mean, he's changed Odysseus's pose, so he's thrown right back, so he shows off the girls much more, not covering over them. You get this kind of suggestive placing of his hand here, that sort of groin level on Nausicaa in the middle. And he's a much more dramatic pose, I think, than this figure in the draft. And I think what you get here is a little sly reference. This is the naked Ulysses. You get a little reference to the branch that he's meant to be holding in front of himself with this these leaves down here. Okay, then Circe, the draft here, exhibits a contortionist striptease artiste looking with a languorous glance at the viewer over her shoulder. You can see their legs slightly parted, wearing high heels. So an explicitly erotic image. The final etching is far more abstract, although suggesting just as much eroticism. So this kind of relatively realistically drawn figure becomes this figure here, so very abstracted and surrounded by kind of writhing bodies as if she's the center of some sort of orgy, which makes me think that Matisse had read Ulysses, because as I say, Ulysses' Circe episode is set in a brothel. You get this figure over here with his hands down and crotch level, these various intertwined bodies round about. Okay, I think we've got time for... You okay? One more, another text? We'll go on. I certainly wouldn't want to end without looking at one of my favourite Odyssey influence texts, if I can call it that. This is by Constantine Cavafy. You can see his dates, 1863 to 1933, and his poem Ithaca from 1911, so actually pre-Joyce. And Cavafy really was a modernist ahead of his time. I mean, his poetry seems remarkably to anticipate many of the aspects of modernism, the kind of irony, the undercutting of notions of stable reality and so on. He lived almost, although he was Greek and wrote in Greek, he lived almost his entire life in Alexandria, in Egypt. He was a gay man, and he very, you know, courageously for his time wrote, you know, he always talked about his love, or so it's never quite explicit, but he certainly doesn't cover up the fact of his sexuality. Okay, here are the opening lines of Ithaki, sort of looks like in Greek. I can say it for you in Greek if you like. I love this one. Savieston piemoi atin Ithaki. That's the first line. Na efchesai nanae makriso dromos yematos peripetias yematos gnosis. Setting out on the voyage for Ithaca. This is on page? It's 6. You must pray that the way be long, full of adventures and experiences. And if you look at the text there, you'll see the beginning of the next paragraph in column 1. He repeats that line, hope that the voyage is a long one. Hope the voyage is a long one. Sorry, this translation is my own one. It's a bit different from what you've got on the text there. So line 2 and the first line of the next paragraph are the same, stressing the idea of the notion that it's the voyage, the journey, that's important, rather than the destination. Interestingly, and I think anticipating people like Joyce, if you look at the lines 4 onwards, Laestrygonians and Cyclops, angry Poseidon, don't be afraid of them. You'll never find things like that on your way, as long as you keep your thoughts raised high, as long as a rare excitement stirs your spirit and your body. Laestrygonians and Cyclops, wild Poseidon, you won't encounter them unless you bring them along inside your soul, unless your soul sets them up in front of you. So he psychologizes these episodes of the Odyssey, seeing them as kind of mental and emotional states that people create monsters for themselves. And you know, it's a lot like what Joyce does with the Odyssey episodes in Ulysses. So hope the voyage will be a long one. What kind of voyage? Talks about sensual perfumes of every kind and repeats that in the last line of that first column. As many sensual perfumes as you can. So your voyage must be a sensual one, and he tends to put rather more stress on that than rather perfunctorily. May you visit many Egyptian cities to gather stores of knowledge from their scholars. So knowledge as well as emotional and sensual experience. And then I quote the next couple of lines in the preface to my translation of the Odyssey, because that's how I felt going to Ithaca, getting old. Keep Ithaca always in your mind. Arriving there is what you're destined for. But do not hurry the journey at all. Better it lasts for years, so you're old by the time you reach the island, wealthy with all you've gained on the way, not expecting Ithaca to make you rich. So again, the notion that the destination is less important than the journey. Ithaca gave you this marvelous journey, so the importance of Ithaca is that you made you take the journey. And if you find her poor, Ithaca won't have fooled you. Wise as you will have become, so full of experience, you will have understood by then what these Ithacas mean. To me also, I think Ithaca, you know, as this kind of destination for you, for the traveler, also represents